There's no sports league unlike it anywhere in the world, where cartoons and football come together. This is the United States Cartoon Football League, celebrating its 40th anniversary.
Greetings, cartoon and football fans, and especially fans of literary fiction. This is Bob Mozart of the USCFL Network welcoming you to this contest as we will rate and review stories written by Robbie Graham about his creation and the world's newest superheroine, Fashion Girl. Here's how this contest works. Fashion Girl and only Fashion Girl is participating, and football scoring will once again be used. The scores we give will also be done by a percentage rate. 120 points is the maximum score, and 100% will be the maximum percentage. There will also be an excerpt courtesy of Alexa, the Amazon app. In addition, Robbie will give you the backstory of each style chick and how they came to be. As we begin round 9, Fashion Girl has a score of 56 points out of a possible 64 and a percentage rate of 46.7%. This round is the first of a two-part story. Part 2 of the story will take place in round 12. After we take a brief pause, we will begin round 9 of The Adventures of Fashion Girl, Fighting Crime with Style, and this week's story, Aldornia Lives, Part 1. Final Adventures of Fashion Girl, Book 2, Aldornia Lives, Part 1. Chapter 1. Fashion Girl is still troubled by the dream she had about being the evil Aldornia. She is also troubled by the knowledge that the dream was placed in her sleeping mind by Satan. Even though he promised that he would not do so again, Fashion Girl knows that he is the Prince of Lies and worries that he may once again use her in his plots against mankind. She has been seeing a therapist and taking prescribed medications, but is still anxious about what the future might bring. Chapter 2. Victoria, Macy, and Godiva are monitoring news and police channel reports on crimes. From Salem, Massachusetts, they are shocked to find a report of a woman whose description matches Aldornia and who is using supernatural powers in a wave of destruction. After debating the ramifications, they call in Fashion Girl, who in turn calls in the rest of the style chicks. Fashion Girl wonders if this woman is Draven, the former girlfriend of the false prophet Lucifer, whose real name was Horus, and if Draven has been granted her powers by Satan for some nefarious plot. As for the ersatz Lucifer, he had died in a prison hospital from the burns he received from his once and final battle with Fashion Girl when she was Phoenix. Chapter 3. Fashion Girl continues her regular life as Daphne, a mother and wife and mother. After a couple of weeks, she is shopping with Sephora when Aldornia shows up and challenges Fashion Girl to a fight. In the end, Fashion Girl is felled by a lightning strike from Aldornia, who leaves the scene in triumph. Fashion Girl is taken to the hospital, where she succumbs to the after effects of the massive charge of electricity. The style chicks determined to honor her and continue her fight for justice. This ends part one of Aldornia Lives. We will now briefly pause before returning for the wrap-up and scoring.
At the hospital, the paramedics ran Fashion Girl literally into the ER as doctors and nurses continued to work on her. The others came to Sephora's side. Tiffany asked, "Sephora, what happened?" Sephora answered, fighting back tears, "Oh, Tiffany, it was horrible. That crazy woman approached Fashion Girl, and they fought. She was no match for Aldornia. She literally barbecued Fashion Girl. She's been unconscious now for nearly an hour." Tiffany asked, "Why didn't you help her?" Sephora answered, "Don't you remember, Tiffany? Fashion Girl told us that if Aldornia came, she would have to fight her alone. All I could do was watch and make sure nobody else in the area got in the way or got hurt." 3 hours passed with no word on Fashion Girl's condition. Dean was notified as to what happened and rushed to the hospital. Dean asked, "Any word on Fashion Girl?" Sephora answered, "No, Dean. The doctors have worked frantically on her since we arrived. Dean, Fashion Girl is a very brave woman. She put up the fight of her life, but simply was no match for that evil monster. Dean asked, "Evil monster? You mean that?" Sephora answered, "Yes, I mean Aldornia Lives." Another hour passed until a doctor came into the waiting room. He said, "Ladies, I'm Dr. Nicholas Hammond. I've been working on Fashion Girl since she was brought here. I'm sorry to have kept you all waiting with no updates. I wanted to make sure of everything before I gave you any news." Dean stood up and said, "Dr. Hammond, I'm Dean Simpson. I'm Fashion Girl's husband. I came here after I was notified of what happened. Tell us, how is she?" Dr. Hammond replied, "Mr. Simpson, Fashion Girl is truly the stylish crime fighter, with the emphasis on fighter. At first, we couldn't determine if she would survive or not. From what I understand, she was hit by a concentrated bolt of lightning. A strike like that would kill a regular person instantly. Fashion Girl didn't suffer any burns, but she did sustain a concussion. She's awake and alert, which are both good signs. She's been asking for all of you." Dean asked, "Can we see her doctor?" Dr. Hammond answered, "Yes, but only for a few minutes and only two of you can go in." Tiffany turned to Dean and said, "Dean, you and Sephora go. We'll wait here." When they entered the room, Fashion Girl said with a faint smile, "Dean, Cindy, I'm so glad to see you both." Dean put her hand in his and replied, "Daphne, I'm glad you are all right." Sephora added, "You gave us all a scare." Fashion Girl said, "I don't know how I was able to survive." Fashion Girl's breathing became labored as she tried to continue. "I underestimated the power she has. I, Dean, Cindy, please help me. I can't breathe." The monitor that was checking Fashion Girl's heart rate and pulse suddenly flatlined. Sephora ran out and shouted, "Doctor, nurse, anyone, come quick." Dr. Hammond and three nurses rushed in to once again perform CPR. Dr. Hammond prepared the defibrillator and told everyone to clear. The first attempt was unsuccessful. Dr. Hammond prepared it again and told everyone to clear. The second attempt was also unsuccessful. He tried one last time saying, "Come on, Fashion Girl, please don't fail us now." The third and final attempt was unsuccessful. Dr. Hammond and the nurses came out with their heads hung low. Dr. Hammond told everyone, "I'm sorry, everyone. I tried to save her, but we were too late. Fashion Girl is dead." Everyone began to cry except for Dean, who grabbed Dr. Hammond by the coat and said, "You're lying. Tell me you're lying." Dr. Hammond replied, "Mr. Simpson, I wish I were, but I'm telling the truth. My nurses performed CPR, I used the defibrillator three times, and now she's gone. I'm very sorry for your loss, all of you." Everyone turned to Tiffany and Victoria said, "I guess as of now, Tiffany, you're the leader of the Style Chicks. What will be your first order of business?" Tiffany replied in an angry tone of voice, "What will be my first order of business? Fashion Girl just died. We can't just go on like nothing happened. What's the matter with you, Vicky? But I guess if you want to know, the only thing we can all do now, prepare for Fashion Girl's funeral." Sephora said, "Fashion Girl suffered the same fate as her mother did, both killed in an ambush. I don't know how any of us can break the news to the twins or her father." Tiffany replied, "Since you're their aunt, it's your duty as family to tell the twins. I'll break the news to her father." Sephora said, "I guess you're right, Tiffany. If you will all excuse me, I think I'm going to be sick." As Sephora ran to the nearest restroom, Penny said, "Can we blame her? I don't feel so good either." Tiffany replied, "Penny, my dear friend, how I wish right now that you could bring her back to life." Penny said, "I wish I could too, Tiffany, but you know I can't." Macy added, "My potions won't work either, mates." Tiffany replied, "I guess there's nothing more we can do here. Let's go home." And this was where this story will stand for now, to give you the cliffhanger effect. At the end of this book, we will have the conclusion to this story. In the meantime, enjoy what the rest of these stories has to offer. To be continued.
And now for Belle Kay's backstory. Before Belle Kay was born, her parents lived in Bogota, Colombia, and fled the country during the drug cartel wars of the late 1980s. Once settled in America, they started their new life, and soon a daughter would enter the picture. That daughter was Belle Kay. She was born Alicia Lopez in the summer of 1995 in Miami, Florida, and is the second youngest style chick. Growing up in a mostly Hispanic community, Alicia's father wanted her to always respect her heritage, but to also live like an American. That meant she was to speak, read, and write fluent English. However, Alicia had a quinceañera at 15, which in Latin cultures meant that she was no longer a little girl, but a young woman. A year later, she learned how to drive, and her father bought her a Mercedes on her 16th birthday. But when Alicia was to go off to college, her parents were deported back to Colombia. However, Alicia didn't have to go with them because she was born in America. Their next-door neighbors, both were lawyers, tried to stop the deportation, but failed. Not only were Alicia's parents were deported, but the feds also froze their assets, which meant that Alicia was not only broke, but homeless. She spent the next 4 years on the mean streets of downtown Miami and had to sell her car, and eventually had to panhandle to make enough money to eat once a day. She also had to fight off men who wanted to score with her. Her father paid for her to learn karate and became a black belt. Around the time Fashion Girl was on her honeymoon with her first husband, she saw Alicia fight off those men and rescue her. She saw in her the makings of a good style chick. Fashion Girl gave Alicia the name Belle Kay, for which the people in Colonia didn't approve of. However, Alicia reassured the people that she was nothing like the Belle Kay that preceded her. Fashion Girl made Alicia a co-guardian of the junior style chicks with Sephora, and they moved to Atlanta. Belle Kay proved to any doubters that she was a good, kind-hearted person who cares about others. She even got the chance to reunite with her childhood and high school sweetheart, and his parents made her an honorary member of the family. Belle Kay is derived from Belk, a chain of department stores located in the southeastern United States, but there are no Belk stores in the Miami or South Florida area. Regardless of what role she plays in the style chicks, Belle Kay is always pretty in pink.
This is the first of a two-part story. It mostly sets the stage for the sequel and ends with a cliffhanger. There are a lot of unanswered questions that remain to be resolved. I give this story a 6. As always, viewers are invited to submit their own reviews and scores. The book, The Final Adventures of Fashion Girl by Robbie Graham, is available on Amazon.com. Tune in next week for another Fashion Girl story review. This is Bob Mozart of the USCFL Network signing off.